Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Rosen Pereira. Prime Minister Narendra Modi began a three-nation, five-day tour to Africa today. The visit to Africa comes ahead of the 10th BRICS Summit in Johannesburg. First on the Prime Minister's itinerary is Rwanda, being referred by the Ministry of External Affairs officials as the gateway to Africa. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyse India's Africa outreach. Joining me on the programme today are Suresh K. Goyal, former diplomat, Sriram Chawla, Dean, Jindal School of International Affairs, and Harshvi Pant, Head, Strategic Studies, Observer Research Foundation. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Professor Sriram Chawla, you know, as far as Rwanda is concerned, what are the possible areas of, you know, of cooperation between India and Rwanda, and how do you see this relationship going forward?
Frank, Rwanda is a small country with an outsized disproportionate influence in the region because the regime of Paul Kagame has consolidated power and has built a strong military and also a thriving economy since the genocide of 1994. So it's a great success story in one way. Although,
so it's been punching above its weight.
Definitely. And I think what Paul Kagame did when he visited India last year was insist, you know, they wanted to upgrade the partnership to a strategic level. So we are now counting Rwanda as one of our strategic partners, which is a big deal because just 12 million people, landlocked, small country, but has outsized influence, as I said. And secondly, I think the defense cooperation is also being spoken about. Harsh is right that economics is up front. Well, Paul Kagame wants to attract a lot of Indian investors there. And traditionally, we have done more with the East African community countries like Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. And Prime Minister has already visited Kenya, Tanzania, and this time he will be covering Uganda, where there's a big landmark speech to Parliament about India's philosophy towards Africa and all that. That's much to look forward to. But Rwanda itself, I will say, is, you know, a country like Mozambique or a country like Rwanda, which Prime Minister is now visiting for the first time, I think signifies that, as Harshi is saying, that we want to intensify engagement beyond the old traditional partners. And I'm surprised that we have not included a West African nation yet in the PM's agenda. But overall, if you see, 23 outgoing visits by Indian President, Vice President and Prime Minister in the last 4 years. So that shows that, you know, we have really prioritized Africa much more than before. The South-South cooperation we're talking about, Frank, this time, you know, also includes entrepreneurship training. We are giving a line of credit for industrial zone, special economic zone in Rwanda. And remember, the Chinese, as Harsh is mentioning, are already there. They have financed garment factories, which are generating jobs for Africans. And the Africans are also talking about the fourth industrial revolution, whether they can be part of it, because so far, except South Africa and to some extent Nigeria, most of Africa has been in a pre-industrial state. And right, for them to grow and to generate jobs for their youth, I think they are looking forward to India as one more option beyond the Chinese juggernaut.
Frank, just on this, the distinction China and India, you know, Xi Jinping is going to dedicate more loans for highways, for roadways, for railways, for ports and those kind of things. And he continues to do that. On the other hand, our Prime Minister, one of the highlights is going to be he is going to give 200 cows in a rural part of Rwanda as part of Paul Kagame's you know, social mobility project. And I think on agriculture, on solar electricity, electrification, we have done more and better than the Chinese. So if you think about it one way, the Chinese model enables elites in Africa and well-connected people to make a lot of money and to keep on growing. And of course, it gives physical infrastructure, no doubt, that has, that creates public goods. But on the other hand, our model is, as Ambassador was saying, based on human resource potential and capacity building. And at the same time, what we are trying to do is, you know, engage with Africans on a face-to-face basis rather than in a very impassive and an impersonal way, which is the Chinese model. So in the long run, we will not, we don't face as much of a backlash as the Chinese do, and that's something for which I think we should continue doing that.
Sure. You know, Professor, I'm going to go back to a point that the ambassador was making about how we've dealt with Africa. It's not something new, but we've dealt with them as a block. Only more recently are we looking at countries individually. Is that the right way forward? Because each country has its own identity, has its own ambitions, so we look at bilaterals rather than multilaterals or trilaterals?
It's not an either or, Frank. In fact, you know, Africa is broken into smaller economic sub-markets. So there is, for example, the ECOWAS community in West Africa. There is the SADC community in Southern Africa, and so on. There is a Sahel group in Northern Africa, closer to the Arab Maghreb. So I think the right strategy would be to actually integrate with all of these. And the fact that Rwanda holds the African Union chair, and we should be actually engaging with these subgroups in a more systematic fashion. And that's how you make inroads, because you see, the agreements for removing tariffs and trade barriers already, by the way, our viewers should know, India-Africa cumulative trade is over 100 billion. So when we say the European Union is our largest trading partner, it's more or less the same. It's 100 billion. United States also 100 billion. But somehow we say, oh, USA and Europe are somehow strategic and Africa is only economic. No, it's not. You see, if you look at it in that sense, the scale of it and the demographics and the gradual democratization that's happening with some good examples lately, especially in Ethiopia, we are looking at, you know, in the long run, I think this is going to be, you know, people talk about the bottom billion and how Africa is rising and all that. I think we are surging at the right time. And indeed, the pace, our pace will always be slower because we can't put the kind of resources the Chinese put on the table. But at the end of the day,
but we bring something else to the table.
We are bringing something qualitatively different. You know, the famous quote of Jakaya Kikwete, the former Tanzanian leader, was that, you know, all the hospitals in our country are built by the Chinese, but all the nurses and the doctors there are trained by the Indians. So I think we have to keep on doing that. But at the same time, I'll say that we have to look at some regions of Africa which we have not touched as well. The ones that are further away, for example, the Gold Coast, Ghana, Senegal, you know, Nigeria, you know, during the Boko Haram crisis, for example, you know, which has been an ongoing thing there in that region, we have not been very visible and upfront in providing either security assistance or in somehow, you know, helping the Nigerians to counter this and the remaining countries like Cameroon and Chad. So, you know, our vision has to go beyond the east coast of Africa. Rwanda is a good start because it's not exactly a coast. We are already moving. So Western Indian Ocean, yes, definitely for defense.
We are moving inwards. It's just about, just about time before we
go continental. Go continental and, you know, spread westwards until we reach the Atlantic side. Because from the Indian Ocean to the Atlantic, that is the pivotal space, you know.
You know, quick closing comment from you, Professor Chawla. You know, as far as Prime Minister Modi's three-nation tour is concerned, what is it that we would like to take away from this three-nation tour?
I think, Frank, we are making a big statement by sending out VVIPs from our side and also hosting large numbers of VIPs from their end. And what we need to do is really more grassroots-based projects at which we are adept, but also, you know, bringing the human connect. I mean, I've always advocated that we should have Indian volunteers like the Peace Corps go and live in selected countries in Africa, teach in schools and colleges there with the support of Indian government, build our soft power at that level. So we need also fresh ideas. And as I said, geographically, we need to diversify beyond the East Coast and the Southern Africa. And I think these are the, you know, messages we are sending, that slowly but slowly we are, you know, penetrating deeper in a way that will be consultative and will also involve the Africans. The Asia-Africa growth corridor must move ahead. It's been a little bit low-key and low-profile since it's been announced. And I think the Japanese and we need to work very closely together to bring the financing there, because otherwise, if, you know, money is power, then, you know, the Chinese will continue to rule the roost.
All right. On that note, then, we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. What's coming out of the debate is that we need to concentrate a little more on Africa. We need to deliver on the projects that we take up, and we also need to move, you know, across the continent and make our presence felt there, is what the panelists are saying. On that note, it's a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. See you again next time.